Well, good morning, all you lovely people. Welcome to worship this morning as we gather to give thanks for life and breath and the gift of community, and then recognize that God is at the heart of it all. Welcome to those of you who are also joining us by live stream, as we are a community of faith connected together in person and in a virtual way. So we welcome you all. My name is Ivan Herman, associate pastor. My colleague Keith is away this weekend, and glad for it. And many folks are away this weekend for Memorial Day weekend. But whether you are physically here or traveling and maybe watching this later, we are glad that you are part of this community of faith. I hope that you all signed in as you came in. If you didn't, sign out as you leave. And those of you who are joining us online, also please sign in using the link that takes you to a Google form. And we do that so that we know that we are together and we know who we are together. Take a look in your parish notes today. You will see a number of things happening in the life of the congregation. There's coffee fellowship today following the worship service. There is also a session meeting, briefly, I hope, to examine a few of our incoming deacons who were unable to be with us last week. So we'll have that in McMillan Hall, but coffee fellowship is in the gathering place for everyone else. Hope you will enjoy that together. Next Saturday is a Covenant Network of Presbyterians covenant conversation happening at Westminster Presbyterian Church, working toward the church becoming a more inclusive community of faith, particularly for LGBTQ folks. And if you want to be a part of that conversation, come and ask me about it. I'll be glad to provide information about that day. We'll have a number of great speakers and preachers, worship opportunities, and workshops. Next Sunday, June 5, is going to be Youth Sunday, and I hope that you all will come and hear and support our youth and children as they lead our worship service next week. Because we've got so much going on with that, we are going to host a communion service in the chapel immediately following the worship. So if that's something that tugs on your heart next week, come and join us in the chapel at about 11 o'clock for a brief communion service together. And then after that, and some coffee fellowship and time together, we're going to adjourn everybody to go over to an all-church picnic on June 5, and you're going to hear more about that in a few minutes' time. Also coming up, solar committee opportunity. We're having conversations about what it would look like to put in solar power here at the church. And that conversation is being organized by Len Tozier, and you can see more about that, looking for folks to help be a part of that conversation. The first meeting is going to be June 3rd, this Friday at 10 a.m. in the library. So if your heart is being tugged in that direction, come and join that conversation as well. There's a lot else going on too, so keep an eye on those parish notes. Come and keep joining us. Call into the church office, which will be closed tomorrow for Memorial Day. But call in and just have some conversations with folks as we continue to build community together and be engaged in our world together. So now, as promised, I'd like to invite Ann Parker to come up and tell us more about the all-church picnic next week.
Good morning. Memorial Day unofficially marks the beginning of the summer season, and before temperatures begin to soar, as we know they will, we look forward to gathering together as a community of Christ followers to disconnect from the busyness of daily life and reconnect with each other at our all-church picnic. Whether you've been a member of CPC long enough to be recognized last weekend on Heritage Sunday, or whether you've never set foot in the sanctuary, you are welcome to join us at the All Church Picnic next Sunday, June 5th, starting at noon at Gibbons Park. Bring your own meal and a dessert to share. Better yet, bring a pie for our pie bake-off, where judges will rate the pies and crown a winner. There will be a prize. If baking is not your style, however, and you prefer eating, we need a few judges. So just let me know. We have several activities lined up for people of all ages. We have church family kickball, giant-sized Yahtzee, giant Jenga, cornhole, a playground nearby, and petanque. So have you ever heard of petanque before? It's a wonderful game similar to bocce ball, and we're going to have an experienced player on hand to teach you how to play. We have a shaded area with several picnic tables for our use, or you can bring your own chair or your own blanket. If you've been thinking about inviting a friend to church, this picnic is a perfect opportunity. In fact, it's a great chance to get to know people you may recognize but haven't had the pleasure of knowing. So please wear your name badges. I know I will appreciate it because I will likely forget your name. The weather forecast indicates the temperatures will be in the high 70s. With great weather and good company in store, I'm sure you'll all agree this is a gathering you won't want to miss. I look forward to spending time with you next Sunday at noon at Gibbons Park. Information about the picnic is in the parish notes, on Facebook, and in the mission bell. And I will be in the gathering place. Oh, I was going to say I was going to be in the gathering place after the service, but I will be over in the session meeting. So if you have questions, please feel free to give the church office a call, and they can answer any questions you may have. Look forward to seeing you next Sunday. I don't see Barb Farley. Do you want me to go into? You want to do it? Okay.
Please rise in body and or spirit. Long ago, our ancestors asked for God's name.
God became known as the Great I Am.
The Alpha and the Omega.
The first and the last.
The beginning and the end.
The bright morning star.
Come, worship God.
Who was and who is and who is to come, the Almighty.
Please join me in singing, Be Thou My Vision. having defeated sin and conquering death, the risen Christ beckons us, welcoming our confession and promising new life. Trusting in the promise of the gospel, let us confess our sin together in prayer. Holy God, we confess that we are caught up in our own timeliness. We want to see promises fulfilled in our lifetime and into poverty and corruption, the saving of our earth from climate change, the powerless lifted up and the powerful brought down. We want peace on earth now and to live in harmony the rest of our days. Like the disciples, we confess we desire your kingdom to come to earth with worldly power. Instead of us working for your reign on earth as it is in heaven, call us into your ways and to know that while we may not see the fulfillment in our lifetime, our work is necessary and our love matters. Neither sin, nor doubt, nor injustice, nor poverty, nor death, nor anything else in all creation can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. That is good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen.
Thank you, Beth. I'd like to invite children and their friends and come up and have a seat on the stairs here with me, on the steps. I've got a book I want to read today. So maybe, let's see, I'm going to sit down here on the very bottom. I'm going to sit on the floor, and I want you to sit where you can look over my shoulder and see this book. The rest of the congregation is just going to have to see the top of my head, which I know is a great view, shiny even. So this book is called God's Dream by Archbishop Desmond Tutu and Douglas Carlton Abrams. Yeah, do you know Bishop Tutu? Yeah. He is a wonderful, well, he passed away not long ago, but he's a wonderful, wonderful man of God, and he speaks in ways that are simple to understand and still profound to teach about God.
I have a question. Understand for grown-ups or kids?
I think for all of us, grown-ups and kids. So here's the story. It's called God's Dream. Dear child of God, what do you dream about in your loveliest of dreams? Do you dream about flying high or rainbows reaching across the sky? Do you dream about being free to do what your heart desires or about being treated like a full person, no matter how young you might be? Do you know what God dreams about? If you close your eyes and look with your heart, I'm sure, dear child, that you will find out. God dreams about people sharing. God dreams about people caring. Look, they're caring for a kitty cat. God dreams that we reach out and hold one another's hands and play one another's games and laugh with one another's hearts. But God does not force us to be friends or to love one another. Dear child of God, it does happen that we get angry and we hurt one another. Soon we start to feel sad and so very alone. There's a little boy sitting here underneath a tree, and the whole group of kids over here are like looking at him like something happened. What do you think?
If you turn back to the other page, he's going to shove him. He was cheating.
Oh, yeah.
He wasn't giving the ball to him, and they weren't sharing. But then on this page, I'm guessing that guy or that girl is older than this little boy. And whoever that is took the ball and like shoved him.
Yeah, so they were playing together, and they weren't playing nicely or fairly and sharing, and so one of the person's feelings got hurt, and he's sitting off in the corner here of the page. What do you think they can do about that? So sometimes we cry, and God cries with us. But when we say we are sorry and forgive one another, we wipe away our tears and God's tears too. So she's wiping away his tears. Yeah, the dog and the cat are licking each other.
Two pages back.
Yeah, you see something a couple pages ago?
They were angry and now...
Oh, I missed that. Thank you for seeing that, Mackenzie. The dog and the cat weren't happy with each other 2 pages ago, but now they are making up. Each of us carries a piece of God's heart within us. And when we love one another, the pieces of God's heart are made whole. And there they are. They're all holding each other's hands, and they're making room for more to come in. Hey, check this out. I just realized I wore my stole with people holding, connected together, kind of like they are here in this picture.
Those are ropes.
Yeah. God dreams that every one of us will see that we are brothers and sisters. Yes, even you and me. Even you and me. Even if we have different mommies and daddies or live in faraway different lands, even if we speak different languages or have different ways of talking to God, even if we have different eyes or different skin, even if you are taller and I am smaller, even if your nose is little and mine is large, dear child of God, do you know how to make God's dreams come true? It's really quite easy. As easy as sharing, loving, caring, as easy as holding, playing, laughing, as easy as knowing we are family because we are all God's children. What kind of party do you think they're having in this picture?
A cupcake party.
A cupcake party.
Cookie party.
A cookie party.
And they're celebrating.
Yeah, and he's blowing a horn, so they're celebrating. Will you help God's dream come true? Let me tell you a secret. God smiles like a rainbow when you do. When you help make God's dream come true, God smiles. And you know what? I think we smile too when that dream comes true.
Look.
What do you notice?
There's the kitty.
The kitty paws, the dog paws,
instead of
and the human handprints in the rainbow. There we are.
Yeah. The hands are really different. So you could see this is like all painted
yeah.
through, and then this one isn't like painted through.
So we talk about the kingdom of God a lot because that's what Jesus talks about. But there are different ways of talking about the kingdom of God, the relationships and community that God calls us into. And one way to talk about that is the way Desmond Tutu talked about that. He talked about it as not just the kingdom of God, but that it is God's dream for us to be together and to love one another. So when you love one another, when you share and care, you make God's dream a reality. That means God's dream is coming true. Yeah, Kai? Your mom's auntie? His name Tutu? That's a great name, isn't it? Yeah. Thank you for coming up, friends. Let's see. Younger ones are welcome to go with Miss Mary to Sunday school this morning, and a very happy Sunday to you all.
Please rise in body or spirit. Join with me in singing Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
God's grace is amazing, and it touches us individually, redeeming us, saving us, but it also does so for our community, for our world, and we are grateful, and that's why we live our lives in gratitude. Well, this morning we turn to the scriptures and we read from Acts chapter 16, verses 16 to 34. Now, the book of Acts and the Gospel of Luke have the same author. Did you know that? Acts and Luke have the same author, and most scholars agree on that. They agree so often that sometimes scholars will take a look at this text and say, really, they're the same thing. It's Luke Acts, right? Luke Acts. I don't go quite that far. I think they're distinct enough that there's the Gospel of Luke. It's like part one, the story of Jesus and his disciples, Jesus' death and resurrection. And then Acts is like Luke part two, Return of the Jedi, Empire Strikes Back. No, it's the story of the disciples after Jesus' ascension that we celebrated this past week. And so the disciples then become apostles as they are sent out into the world, as they scatter, as they are dispersed. But the two parts, Luke and Acts, the reason that it's important to recognize that they are written by the same author is that they share a lot of the same themes, the same theological themes. They're connected through the two writings. So if we think about where we are in the book of Acts in chapter 16, we know that we've been following one of these new characters that's introduced into this second book, the character we call Apostle Paul. Paul is traveling. He travels with Barnabas, and then he joins up with Silas and Timothy, and they travel through Asia Minor, and then they begin sailing around the Aegean Sea to Macedonia, or what we call today the Aegean coast of northern Greece. And they travel, and Paul is not a professional missionary, right? He's a traveling businessman. His business is he makes tents. And he's in this tent-making business, and he picks up his tents, and he goes, and he sells them in the next place, and in the next place, and the next place. And as he arrives in these towns and cities, he does his business in the day, but in the afternoon and evenings, he goes to the synagogue, because that's where he finds community. And when he's in the synagogue, he begins teaching about this guy named Jesus. And his message of salvation, his message of love and grace, his way of understanding God. And when folks come to faith through that message, he baptizes households of those whose hearts are open to this liberating message. And no matter their gender, no matter whether Jew or Gentile, young or old, they come to faith, and that faith is recognized and honored. So Paul and his companions come to the city of Philippi, a Roman city on that northern coast, and they meet Lydia, the dealer of purple cloth, and we heard her story last week. And they begin to stay in her household and in her home, and this is what happens next, beginning with verse 16 of chapter 16. One day, as we were going to a place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune-telling. While she followed Paul and us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God, who proclaim to you a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days. But Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to her, and said to the Spirit, "I order you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought them before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing our city. They are Jews, and they are advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods, and after they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was an earthquake so violent that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and he rushed in, and he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At that same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds, and then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up to the house and set food before them, and he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God. The way of salvation of Jesus Christ, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, if you can tell that was a long passage, and you're breathing, you're catching up. It actually keeps going. Paul and Silas are next released from prison by the order of the magistrates that actually find out that they're not just Jews, but they're also Roman citizens, and they have rights under the law. So they know their rights, they press for their rights, and then are released. And I have to admit, as I read that, I thought, boy, this story really needs to come with, like, trigger warnings, right? This story, we've got it all. We've got slavery, we've got oppression of women, we've got abuse of power and suffering, and a lot of this just doesn't get addressed in the text. It's part of the context of the story. And so it raises a lot of unanswered questions, and I'm not going to answer very many of them today. I want to focus instead on what I think the author of Luke Acts wants to tell about, what the author wants us to see in this story. I think the primary focus is that this is a story about the truth and the nature of salvation. Salvation is a key theological theme throughout Luke and Acts. It's one of the major themes, and we hear that first in this passage with the introduction given to Paul and Silas by this truth-telling young woman. These men are slaves of the Most High God who proclaim to you a way of salvation. So what is this salvation? Could you define it if you needed to? If somebody asked you, well, you're a Christian, what does salvation mean? It's a big topic. It's a big concept, and it is it's central to our Christian faith and tradition. The problem is that within our modern usage, the idea of salvation has become equal to this idea that it's about going to heaven. Salvation is about the afterlife. Search any dictionary, and you'll see that is the dominant definition. To be saved in a Christian context means to be saved from sin and the effects of sin. In short, a conversation about heaven and maybe even about hell. We also talk about the saving of souls is another term and phrase that's common within Christianity today. Salvation of souls. My second year of college, I was allowed to keep a car on campus my second year. So I got to drive on my own from Roanoke, Virginia, to Winston-Salem, North Carolina, about 2 hours away. And just south of the Virginia-North Carolina border was the town of Eden, North Carolina. And in Eden, North Carolina, there was an evangelical church that had a billboard out front that, you know, displays those messages a lot of churches have. They change from week to week, month to month. And that one, it always read, "Praise Jesus! 9 souls saved this year." Okay, it kept count of how many souls were saved that year. I'm assuming just in that congregation, not worldwide, okay? When I drove past at Thanksgiving, the number had gone up. Praise Jesus, 11 souls saved this year. And I went back at Christmas, and it was up to 13. I drove back in January, and they had started over again. Praise Jesus, 0 souls saved this year, which is not exactly what I think they meant to convey. But they started over again, and they must have been working really hard because that was awkward. Then I drove home for spring break, and it said 15. And I drove back from spring break, and it said 13. I can't answer that for you. I don't know how to get unsaved. Must have been some spring break. So an illustration to show that salvation has become intertwined with this idea that our souls must be saved and that it has something to do with the afterlife. That we are saved from sin and can spend eternity with God in heaven, and that it's dependent upon us and what we believe and how we act and what we pray and if we've asked Jesus into our hearts. But the thing is, that is not the biblical meaning of salvation. That simply is just not the biblical meaning of salvation. The Bible uses the word salvation, savior, and being saved over 500 times. Two-thirds of them in the Hebrew Scriptures, one-third in the New Testament. Salvation in the Bible is very seldom about the afterlife. Salvation has a broad range of uses. It's homecoming. Being brought back home is salvation. Salvation is life rather than death. Salvation is sight to the blind, the caring and healing of wounds, the healing from illness, and perhaps above all other biblical understandings, salvation is the liberation from the bondage of oppression. That is the biblical primary meaning of salvation, to be liberated from oppression. The stories of Hebrew Scripture from the Exodus from Egypt and later the exile from Babylon, as they return, are stories of salvation. And that salvation is a physical reality, a physical liberation, primarily from economic exploitation, the exploitation of slavery and captivity. That's the primary meaning in the Bible. And so we see here in the story of Paul, with this, starting with the slave girl, that she is being exploited economically by those who own her, for her skill, for her ability to tell the truth. Paul gets annoyed. You caught that in the text. He gets annoyed with the fact that she's following them around and telling the truth, and so he casts out this spirit from her. While his motivation seems to be a little bit less than noble and is prompted by his irritation, his annoyance, he liberates her from being economically exploited. Her owners get upset, and Paul and Silas get thrown into the deepest, darkest prison they could find, their feet bound in stocks. And prisons in the first century in the ancient world are primarily not about violent crime. There were other methods for dealing with violent crime. But in the ancient world, to land in prison meant probably one of two things: that you owe somebody money and you're in economic trouble, or you're in some kind of political trouble. And in Paul and Silas's case, they're in both. Okay? So during the night, they sing, they pray, they witness, and the chains fall off, and they are set free, along with all of the other prisoners. And they don't escape, which is an odd thing in this particular context. But they don't escape, and the jailer thinks that they've all run away and is ready to take his own life. I'm imagining what was going through the jailer's mind. What kinds of calculations is he making? If they've escaped, people are going to be owed a whole lot of money, and it's going to be on his head. Or he's made a whole bunch of political enemies because they've all been able to run out. And so he's going to take his own life. And Paul and Silas cry out to him, "Wait." And then the first question he asks of them is, "What must I do to be saved?" He's not concerned about the afterlife, folks. He is concerned about the violent and oppressive context of his own life and the way he's living it. Are we familiar with that kind of context this week of violence and oppression? If violence can devastate a school in Uvalde, a Presbyterian church in Laguna Woods, a grocery store in Buffalo, then it's only a matter of time before it devastates us too. What must we do to be saved? It brings up within us an emotion, doesn't it? What is that emotion but fear? It brings up within us fear, and Jesus offers a way of salvation that confronts fear. He says in Luke 12, "Do not worry about your life. Instead, trust, have faith, and strive for the kingdom of God, the reign of God, or as Desmond Tutu puts it, the dream of God. And all of these things will be given to you as well." So salvation, hope in the face of fear, is personal for us, but it's also corporate for us. It includes how we live together in community, how we build our society and our nations together. In other words, salvation is about the kind of world we live in. It is a political promise as well as a personal one. It is a dream that God has for us in how we live together in the world. If we engage this deeper understanding of salvation as being real for this life and where we are, here and now, then the Christian message of salvation is not about keeping a running tally of how many souls are saved. If anything, it's the opposite. It is understanding that God's forgiveness and God's grace are beyond measurement. Salvation is about our liberation from fear. The affirmation that promise of God's reign is true and that it is real and it is here, that it is now. Salvation is coming near. Every time we feed those who are hungry, every time we heed Christ's call to dismantle systems that keep people hungry, every time we love the lonely and speak truth to the powerful and give hope to the hopeless, to show, as Jesus did, compassion for the crowd and healing for the sick, that is the good news of salvation. When we weep together with the victims of the shootings in Buffalo and Laguna Woods and Uvalde, and we pray for the perpetrators and their families, when we call for political reform and expanded health care and mental health care for all so that such events will never happen again, when we do not bow to the threat of terror, but live out of hope, when we dare to lay down our own weapons, when we dare to build communities of peace and let the fear of violence have no foothold in our lives. That is the way of salvation. The dream of God, breaking out of eternity and into our lives here and now. Let's pray. Saving God, you have chosen us and you have elected us for service and for salvation. This is our calling as your people, not to escape what we fear, but to be set free by believing on the Lord Jesus, to believe that his dream, your dream, will transform us and transform the world. There is no border or boundary that you cannot cross. So, O God, we pray that you would connect us to one another even across our differences, that together we shine the light of your saving love. By following Christ and loving one another, we make this prayer our reality. Amen.
Please rise in body or spirit and join me in singing. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sorry.
Hi. I know next Sunday, June 5th, is going to be a very busy day around here, but I want to remind you from the Mission Division that it's also Pentecost Sunday. And when I'm telling you, are you saying speed it up?
No, I'm saying you're like half a step ahead of us. How about we sing first, and we'll come to the Pentecost announcement. You can just stay right where you are, sing in the microphone.
No.
Let's rise in body and spirit. Sing together, Lord, the light of your love is shining.
One, two, three, four.
Sorry for getting ahead of you, Ivan. Barbara Farley was supposed to do this, but since she's not here, you're hearing me off the cuff. Mission Division oversees the Pentecost collection each year, and as I said, it's next Sunday, the 5th. First, you're reminded to wear red, and if you wear red, you'll be reminded to make an offering. That offering goes to our youth and children's programs, both for the Presbyterian USA programs and for our local programs here. Some of those that we get 40% of what you offer next Sunday, and that money goes to the Vacation Bible School, to the Sunday morning school classes, to our youth programs. They go up to Zephyr Point, they go on mission. All of that is covered by your Pentecostal donation. We also give money to the children's program at Loaves and Fishes and Family Promise. So think about it, be generous, and help our kids. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Brenda. I'm always happy when our ruling elders in the church are out in front of me leading the way. So half a step ahead, that's great. Thank you very much. That Pentecost offering, by the way, one of the things that we help support through that is our young adult volunteer program in the denomination. And if you've ever had kids you know who took a gap year, a year of service, that Pentecost offering goes to assist and fund that young adult volunteer program that connects both domestically in the United States, as well as sends volunteers to young adults to Colombia to work on the peace in the church, to the Philippines to work on trafficking issues, human trafficking issues. So that offering next week really makes a big impact as we pool our resources together with other Presbyterian congregations around our nation. And that's one of the ways that we make our offerings every week, is by connecting with one another and pooling our voices as we make a difference in the world in which we live. There are offering boxes here in the front and in the back, but we also offer different things within our lives, different efforts that we make. This week, there's been a lot, because of the shooting in Uvalde in particular, there's been a lot of question about what is the role of prayer without action? What is the role of prayer without action? And one of the ways that we act together as a community of faith is that we make our voices heard. And we speak to our political and elected leaders. If you are interested, you can go and Google PCUSA voter voice. And you will see options for connecting with your elected leaders on different issues that have been spoken to by our General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church, including gun violence and violence prevention. Relationships with Cuba and Colombia and Iran and different parts of the world that are in the news, it seems, every day. So that could be for you a spiritual discipline, a way of offering yourself and your voice to further the work of God's dream. So I invite you to pray with me now as we bless what it is that we give, all of our efforts and all of our financial offerings. Let's pray. God of grace, you work through us and with us, and you work for us. For your great love embraces us and leads us to new and renewed relationships. Bless what we give, bless what we do, that in what we do and what we give, we share the good news of your love and your connection with us. We pray all of this as we seek to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen. I invite you to turn to page 2 of your parish notes, and we see a prayer list there of folks, and we'll add Barbara Farley to this list. She was supposed to be here this morning, but instead she's over at Kaiser Morse going through some testing because she's not feeling well. So Tim contacted me this morning, said she's got some arm pain and things that might lead one to believe there's a heart problem, but all early tests are it's not. So for Tim and for Barbara today and for those who are caring for them, we ask God's watch and blessing on them. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We lift up prayers for those who have and continue to struggle with COVID. It's running rampant through our community. It's running rampant through our schools. My daughter's down with it this morning. Garrett Torgerson's down with it today. So it's touching us, and we pray for healing. And give thanks for healing for those who have gone through this already. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We pray for Mary Torgerson as she continues in hospice care. We pray for her family. This is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We also lift up prayers for Sylvia Eckberg, Kate Eisel's mom. She turned 100 in April and has recently suffered a stroke and is in hospice care as well. So we pray for Sylvia and for Kate and for Jack as they surround and love her in these days. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. And of course, we lift up prayers for those who are deeply affected by violence, gun violence, war. And we pray for the role of the church in speaking truth and speaking peace. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. Let's pray together. God, the heavens declare your glory. The firmament shows the work of your hands. One day tells its tale to another, and each night imparts knowledge to the next. The sun, the moon, the seas, and the dry lands, the plants that enrich the earth, the creatures that swim and fly and run, all these gifts of your creation, although they have no words or language, their sound goes out to all the lands, their messages to the ends of the earth. We offer our prayers for the earth and recommit ourselves to honor and protect it. May we hear the cries of creation and see in its beauty and power your own image and your deep love for what you have made. We know that for you, O God, all life is like an ocean, all is flowing and bending, and that when we withhold any measure of love from anything in your universe, we withhold that same measure of love from you. Lord God, as we pray, we bring our sisters, brothers, siblings, strangers, and neighbors into your presence. We rejoice with those who rejoice today, those who have found love, those who have been healed of disease, those who look forward to marriage or the birth of children, those who have meaningful work and happy families, and those who have safe and happy homes, those who worship you in freedom and the beauty of holiness. And we weep today with those who weep today, those who are sick in their bodies, their minds, their spirits, those who have lost beloved children and parents to gun violence, those who have lost jobs, or who cannot find meaningful work and struggle for ways to use their gifts, those who flee their own lands and homes, seeking refuge and the strength and grace of a new community. By your Holy Spirit, hold the church together in unity and keep us faithful to your word, so that breaking bread together we may be one with Christ in faith and love and service, now and forever. We pray these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite you to rise in body or spirit and hear this charge and benediction, a blessing to know that God's love is upon you, surrounding you, imbuing you, filling you up so that it may overflow into the world around you. That love is known to you by the connections you have with family, with friends, and with this church community. So go forth, people of God, and serve in love. Lift up the brokenhearted and stand with the oppressed. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Go in peace.